Okay, so are we ready for the word this morning? All right, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings, and we're going to be in chapter 20. First Kings chapter 20, and we're going to be looking at verses 1 to 4. Are we all there? And Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, gathered all his hosts together, and there were 32 kings with him, and horses, and chariots. And he went up and he besieged Samaria and warred against it. And he sent messengers to Ahab, king of Israel, into the city and said unto him, Thus saith Ben-Hadad, Your silver and your gold is mine, your wives also, and your children. Even the goodliest are mine. And the king of Israel answered and said, My Lord, O king, according to the saying, I am thine and all that I have. What a situation. In our text this morning, we see the outcome of a war between Syria and Samaria. Samaria evidently had lost the war. They were captured. And having captured Samaria, Mr. Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, felt that he can easily overrun Israel as he did with the Samaria. And so he sent messengers to Ahab, who is king of Israel, stating very emphatically, he says, Your silver and your gold is mine, your wives also, and your children, even the goodliest are mine. Evidently, Ben-Hadad was confident that Israel could now be defeated by him, and as such, he was making this demand of King Ahab of Israel. Can you ever imagine someone having the advantage over you and coming and making such demands? Especially if you know, as in the case of Ahab, that to refuse the demand will result in more chaos. For not only will he take what he had asked, but there will be much more problems for Israel if they were to lose the war. If Syria were to invade Israel, they would plunder the city. So here is Ahab in the straits. All that Ben-Hadad is asking for, he must give, or alternatively, he must fight, but he knew he could not win the war because Syria had just invaded Samaria and did battle with them. And they lost. So sure was Ben-Hadad of having victory over Israel that he was making this great demand of Ahab. When he says, Your silver and your gold, your wives also and your children, even the goodliest are mine, What in effect Ben-Hadad was demanding of Ahab was that of total surrender. He was demanding that without any war, without me invading Israel, I'm giving you the opportunity to avoid chaos, to avoid loss of lives. I'm giving you the opportunity to surrender unconditionally. This morning, by the Spirit of the Lord, I want to use Ahab's reply to Ben-Hadad as the basis of God's message for us this morning. And I want us to please pay attention. Ahab, recognizing what Ben-Hadad was demanding of him, and realizing that Israel had little hope of victory over Syria, and knowing the consequences of the decline of the demand, or declining demand, as we read in verse 4, the king of Israel answered and said, "My lord, O king, according to the saying, I am thine, and all that I have." Ben-Hadad required of Ahab total surrender. And what Ahab gave to Ben-Hadad was total surrender. Could I say to us here this morning, by the Spirit of the Lord, that what Ben-Hadad required of Ahab is what God requires of us all as children of God. What Ben-Hadad required of Ahab, total surrender, is what God requires of each and every one of us that are born of His Spirit and by virtue are the children of God. And God requires this total surrender in order to avoid us having unnecessary complications in our life. Could I say that to you again? God requires of us total surrender. And I've told you before, I've said it many times, and I'll say it again and again. God is a God of purpose. He never asks anything of us without a purpose. He never tells us anything without a purpose. He's a God of plan. He's a God of purpose. And when He requires total surrender of us, the purpose is not for His benefit, but for our benefit, so as to avoid us having unnecessary complications in our life. And for Him, please listen, and for Him to do for us all that He wills. Oh, it's so important that we understand that. You see, because we are living in an age where more and more the church is moving away from what God requires of it. More and more the people of God are moving away from what God requires of us. And we are hearing all kinds of things, all kinds of doctrines now that suggest that everything is going to be okay as long as you are saved. That's it. You come to church and you are right. But no, God has made certain requirements. As a matter of fact, let me take back that word. If we recognize the fact that He's a commander in chief, is He a commander in chief? Yes. We are supposed to be an army, not so? And He's supposed to be our commander in chief. No commander in chief makes requests of soldiers. Commander-in-chief gives demands. And you either obey the demand or stand the consequence. So that what when we say that God requires of us, rather I would like to say he demands of us total surrender in order to avoid us having unnecessary complications in our lives. And for him, please take note, and for him to do for us all that he wills. The question for us this morning is, have we given him, or are we prepared to give to him total surrender of our lives? Are we? Matthew 6:10 tells us that we are to pray that the Father's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Isn't that so? Should be in your Bibles. This is Jesus that made that statement. Now, if the Father has a will for to be done on earth, can't he just do what he wills to do? Yes, he could. He can do anything. There is nothing that is impossible for God. But if he has detailed a way in which he will do what he wills in heaven for us here upon earth, and that way is that we pray that his will be done, then if we do not pray that his will be done, then his will not be done. Isn't that so? So we are assured that God has will for us in heaven. And I firmly believe that this includes his will in heaven for me, that it be done here upon earth. I firmly believe that God has a will in heaven, in his mind, in his will. He has the things to do for me here upon earth, just as he wills it to be done in heaven. I can't bring myself to believe that God wants me to pray for his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, and that excludes his will for my life. So in effect, what I am saying is that God has a will for each and every one of our lives. God has a will. He wills things to affect every aspect of our lives here upon earth. And he says we must pray for this to happen accordingly. But I ask you this morning, can God's will in heaven for me be done here upon earth if I choose to do what I will and not what he wills? God has a will for every aspect of our lives here upon earth. He says we must pray that it be done, just as it is in heaven. But the question before us now is, could we just pray? Or are we supposed to surrender our wills to his will so that his will could be done for us here upon earth as it is in heaven? I want to make a broad statement to us this morning by the Spirit of God. Total surrender is the gateway to receiving all that God wills for our lives in heaven to be done for us here upon earth. Total surrender is the gateway to receiving all that God wills for our lives in heaven to be done here for us on earth. God has a will to accomplish in every facet of our lives here upon earth. Every single facet. He's an all-knowing God. He's an all-seeing God. He's everywhere present. There's nothing that is hid from him. What is going to happen to you tomorrow, God already knows. What is going to happen to you 100 years? No, you're not going to be around 100 years. But 10 years from now, hopefully we are all around. God knows every single detail of what's going to happen in our lives. And he has planned things for us. Every aspect of our life. God has a plan. He has a will. He said it in Jeremiah 29:11. He says, "For I know the thoughts I think of you. They are good thoughts and not evil, so that you can have the expected end, or that I have planned for you." That's in my thoughts. It's my will for you. But the point is, even if he wills it, and we choose to do our own thing, can his will be fulfilled in our lives? So the point is that total surrender is the gateway to receiving all that God wills for our lives in heaven, here upon earth. God has made known to us some of his wills. All that he will for us here upon earth, he has made some of them known. It is called the revealed will of God. The revealed will of God. He has revealed all that he wills for us, all that he wills for us to do, how we are to behave, our attitudes, our behaviors, what he expects of us. He has willed all this. It's his revealed will. Some of his will he reveals by virtue of the gift of the Holy Spirit of God. 1 Corinthians 12:10 tells us that he gave some to be prophets. He gave some to be this and he gave some to be that. He has given gifts to the church, and through prophetic utterances, God makes his will that is in heaven be made known to us here upon earth. Others of his will, according to Psalm 37, 4 and 5, and I hope it's on the board so we can look at it, he places in our hearts. God places in our hearts his God-given desires, so as we commit our way to him, trust in him, he brings those desires to pass, his will for us. And others that are totally unknown to us, but nonetheless are his will for us in heaven. Totally unknown to us. And you know, sometimes we don't think about this. But if he has a will to be accomplished in your life, and it's not revealed in any way here, either prophetically or through his word or by gifting of the Holy Spirit of God, you must know that his will is there intact for you. It's intact for me. But the question is, can his will be manifested on earth in our lives if our lives are not totally surrendered to him? See, the parts that we have surrendered, the parts that we have surrendered so far, is what he would be able to work with and reveal his will so that we can receive it, because we have gotten to that part of surrender, that stage of surrender. But this is why we went into the Word of God and we saw that Ben-Hadad was not demanding of Ahab a portion of surrender. He wanted total surrender. And this is what God wants for each and every one of our lives. Total surrender, which is the gateway of all that he wills for us in heaven to be done here upon earth. So whether it is his revealed will, or through prophetic utterances, or by way of desires he places in our hearts, or his unknown will for us in heaven, the gateway for all of his will to be accomplished in our lives is that of total surrender. I can't harp on it anymore. It is so important because, as I said at the beginning, the church have come to a place where we have plateaued in our relationship with the Lord. We have arrived. We are saved. We are baptized in the Holy Spirit. We come to church. But it goes beyond this. And this is why sometimes we can be praying about things and God has that in his will for us. And we are praying just as he says, but it's not happening. Why? Is it possible? Is it possible that there are some areas of our lives that are not surrendered to God? Ben-Hadad didn't make any bones about it. He says, your silver and your gold is mine. You say, your wives too. You say, and your children too. And not just your children, the goodliest of them. Total surrender. And this is what God wants of our lives. In order that his will be done for us here upon earth and to keep us, save us from some complications in our life. Do you know why some of the complications that we have experienced in life, do you know how it came about? It's because we chose to do things that we should not have done. We choose to marry somebody to find out later, oh God, why I married that person. Trouble down the road. And across the board in life, we make decisions of our own. Do we go to God to find out, Lord, do you want me to do this? Lord, I want your will to be done in my life with this situation. And you do like, what's his name with the fleece? You do like Gideon, you put out a fleece. Lord, if this is what you will have me to do, open the door, Lord. Let it happen. But if it's not, close the door, Lord. Close the door. And I know some of you do that. And I know that God has closed the door. And I know you went and kicked the door open and go through anyway. I know that. I did it. Close the door, Lord. And he shut it. Bam. You push it open. Because that's what you will to do. Because we are not totally surrendered to God's will for our life. Failing to give what he demands, that Ahab, would have meant that in the long run, he would have lost much more than he could have otherwise gained. If Ahab failed at that point in the message, because if we go on further, we'll see another story. But remember, I'm using this text to bring up across a point of total surrender. If Ahab, up to this point in the text, were to say to Ben-Hadad, man, you take a side. No way. It's very possible that Israel would have been invaded, thousands of lives would have been lost, the city would have been plundered, and it would be total chaos, and he would have lost his silver, and he would have lost his gold, and he would have lost his wives, and his children, and the goodliest of them, same way. But his willingness to totally surrender to Ben-Hadad saved him all those complications. And this is the point that we are making here this morning. How important it is for us to totally surrender our wills, our very will, to the Lord. God has given us a will, and He doesn't interfere with it. He does not interfere with it. But you can surrender your will in every given situation of your life to the will of God. You can. He doesn't override your will. If you surrender it, He can exercise His will in your life according to His plan for you in heaven. What many of us, as believers in Christ, are yet to understand is that salvation is meant to be an exchange of our lives for the life of Christ. To too many in the church world today, salvation means you're saved from eternal damnation, and now you should go to church sometimes. But let me say again that salvation is meant to be an exchange of our life for the life of Christ. Jesus at Calvary first gave His life, and at the point of salvation, an exchange was made. We don't see it like that, but that's exactly how it is. An exchange was made at Calvary. It is finished. He gave up the ghost. His purpose in coming to earth was accomplished. That He can give His life to us. But if He gives His life to us, and we remain holding on to our life, then we find ourselves living two lives. And since His life is the God life and our life is the ungodly life, we are in a quandary. So we must come to the place of understanding that when we embrace Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, an exchange was supposed to have taken place. My life for His life for my life. And we must understand that He is such a good God. He didn't look at the unfairness of the exchange. He didn't look at the unfairness. Listen, that exchange is as unfair as anything else could be unfair. If we look in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah wraps it up very nicely in chapter 61:3. He says, He exchanged us beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for a spirit of heaviness, that we who were sinners might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. What an exchange! Our sinful life was exchanged for His sinless life, all on account of His love, His mercy, His grace, and forgiveness. It was sinful life for sinless life. And in order for that exchange to take place, there had to come to a point of total surrender by Him. He had to totally surrender His life, not a portion. You know, sometimes people ask me, how we should pay tithe? You know, is it by the gross or the net? I have one answer for you. Look at Calvary. Did He do this on the cross? Or was He giving His life on the cross? Is that gross, Annette? A lot of people still fooling God with that, you know. Oh, yes. As if God don't know. In order that exchange to take place, sinful life for sinless life, there had to be a point of total surrender by Jesus Christ. Luke 22:42 records that at the point of total surrender, in the Garden of Gethsemane, he cried to the Father, "If it be you, if you be willing, Father, remove this cup from me." This is the man, Christ. And then, remembering the purpose for which he came, he says, "Nevertheless, not what I will, but thine will be done." That was the point of surrendering his will to the Father. It was a total surrender so that the exchange can take place in our lives. "Not my will, but what you will have me to do, Father. Not how I feel." "It's not how I feel, Father. I know what it's going to cost me. I know I'm going to be in a place where I'm going to have all sin placed upon me. And I know, Father, that you're never going to be able to look upon me on that cross, because you cannot look upon sin, although the church world today thinks it's okay with you. But I know, Father, you cannot look upon sin. And for the first time in all of eternity, you're going to turn your back from me." That was more than the pain that he had to endure. But what did he say? "Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done." Verse 44 tells us, "And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling to the ground." That's intensity. Evidently being man that he was, and not drawing upon his deity, it was not easy for him to face. Apart from the murderous torture, as I said before, he had to face the separation from his Father. But he surrendered his will to his Father's will. This was the climax of a total surrendered life, because thereafter he went and he gave it up at Calvary. And that is what is meant by total surrender, your life. My life. Whatever God wills that you do it no matter what the cost. Could I say that to you again? Whatever God requires of you to do, you do it no matter what the cost. And believe me, when God requires of you to do things, there are some things it's going to cost you. It may cost you your friendship with people. It may cost you your very husband. It may cost you your wife. It may cost you your child. It may cost you your parent. It can be a very, very costly thing. But what did Jesus say? If you love father and mother and sister and brother and all, if you cannot put me in front of them, you're not even worthy of me. Whatever God wills that you do, loved ones, this morning, let this reverberate in your spirit when you would have left here. whatever God wills that you do, and there's a lot of it in here, you do it no matter what the cost. That is total surrender. As Ben-Hadad said to King Ahab, your silver and your gold is mine, your wives also, and your children, even the goodliest, are mine. And Ahab's response was, my lord, and I'm sure he did it very humbly. He wasn't too eager to give him all that he asked for, but he humbled himself and says, my lord, O king, according to the saying, I am thine and all that I have. Like Ben-Hadad to Ahab, God requires of us total surrender to him. It's the only way. It's the only way that his will for us, that is in heaven, whether it be revealed through the word of God, revealed prophetically, whether it's desires placed in our hearts, or his unknown will for us in heaven, only by way of total surrender, only by way of total surrender, only when we are prepared to do whatever God wills that we do, no matter what the cost, only when we are prepared to surrender our wills to him, can we realize all of God's will for our lives. Totally. We will die and we will go to heaven and we will meet the Savior face to face. And he will say, hear what? Check out all that I had for you while you were here upon earth. And we would not have received them all. Why? Because we were not surrendered totally to him. And this is why I believe God doesn't let us know everything. He doesn't let us know all that he has for us. Because he wants us to walk in obedience to him and be totally surrendered. Then when we are totally surrendered, we will know what he willed for us, because then it begins to happen in our lives. Now he does things for us. He's a good God. And the Bible tells us that the goodness of God is designed to bring us to repentance. So he's not waiting until we are so good to bless us. He blesses us, even when we were sinners, not so? Oh yes, when we didn't know him, when we didn't care about him, when our life was full of sin, he loved us and he blessed us. The Bible says he makes the rain to fall on the just as well as the unjust. Even the fool that will say in his heart, there is no God, he blesses. He's a God like that. He's a good fella. Only when we are prepared to surrender totally our wills to his will can we realize all of his will for us here upon earth only. It is so important that we understand this aspect of God, that it is life for life, not his life for part of our life, not his life for the part of our life that we want to yield to him. No, life is life. It consists of every single thing that he requires of us. I like to use illustrations. Jesus did too, and I want to follow him. To illustrate the point, let's turn to Luke chapter 5. And I mean, there could be so many illustrations that I can use. Let's look at Luke chapter 5. Let's take it up from verse 3. This is Jesus. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. Now, let's look at Peter. Who is Peter? We know him as the big fisherman. He was an able-bodied fisherman with years of experience and know-how about fishing. He could have stuck to his reasoning. We went out all night. What are you telling me about? It's all night. I'm a fisherman. I know tides. I know the moon. I know the stars. I know the fish. I've been fishing for all my years, Jesus. You now come on the scene. And you telling me to go out in the deep and throw down my net after I toiled all night and I caught nothing? Peter could have stuck to his reasoning, his personal expertise, and logical thinking, and not launch out into the deep. After all, they had toiled all night. What did Jesus will for Peter? Not that he would catch fish. He had that in his mind. He willed that Peter will get fish that morning. But if Peter had put up an argument with him, could this happen? Could he catch so much fish that did not break? What Peter did was, in spite of his know-how, in spite of his knowledge and his understanding and all that his logical thinking and all that, nevertheless, at thy word, he surrendered his will to the will of Jesus to let down his net, and we see the result. Have I made the point? God has things in his will for you. He has it for me. But he can only release those things to a surrendered will. But we don't know what part needs to be surrendered so that he could release what he has to release. We don't know what part of our lives to be surrendered. So what do? We surrender our all. Total surrender. And then he can do for us what he wills on earth, in heaven, as we pray. God is not a liar. He says, pray that your will be done here on earth. And how many of us are praying? And how many of us are still waiting? And some of us are going to die waiting. Because we have not come to that place of total surrender. Notwithstanding all of his experience and know-how and expertise, he surrendered his will to what Jesus willed that he do, and presto, suddenly, a multitude of fish swim in the net. the fish, where they come from, we don't know. But they just decide. Peter obeyed the Lord. Peter surrendered his will to the will of the Lord. Fellas, let's go to the net. The point is, if we are holding on to things that we will to do, that we will to do, if we are holding on to things, please listen to me this morning, or rather, please listen to the Spirit of God using a piece of mud, a stupid piece of mud. The Spirit of God is saying to us this morning that if we hold on to things that we will to do, contrary to God's revealed will for us through His Word or His spoken Word over our lives or illumination of His Spirit, that aspect of our lives is yet, unless that aspect of our lives is to be surrendered, it's not going to happen. We cannot hold on to what we will. And the church, not Holiness Revival Ministries, or every other church except this one, the people in those churches, they hold on to what they will to do. We do always the things that God will have us do, don't we? We cannot truthfully say that we are totally surrendered when we are holding on to what we will to do, regardless of what God wills that we do. Whatever He says to do, do it. You know, when we read in the book of Proverbs, lean not to your own understanding. We must understand what God says in His Word, that His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are as far as the east is to the west. That is not east of Trinidad, west of Trinidad. Okay? That is not Mayaro, Manzalina, and Shagaramas. No, we are talking about east of the universe. West of the unit, it's as far as that. Nobody can measure it. So we can't really figure out everything that God tells us to do. We must not try to figure it out. If God says to do it, you do it. God tells people, God has told me to do things already that, Lord, you sure it's you talking to me? It's way out. It's way out. And when these things happen, and you attempt to do these things, you're going to find you're getting all kinds of opposition. Because God didn't tell the people that are opposed to you. He told you. And the people, not seeing any logic, not seeing any wisdom, not seeing anything, of course they will come and tell you that's not wise, you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that. And that's where you realize now whether you are totally surrendered to the Lord. Are you going to listen to the people who is making all the sense in the world? Or are you going to do something that God tells you to do and you can't figure any sense in it? Am I making the point?
Yes.
When we are totally surrendered, we cannot listen to what people say. We have to do what God says, regardless of the cost, regardless of what people say, regardless of what people think, how they feel about you. You cannot think about that. If you are totally surrendered, you will do what God says to do. Let Him work it out. Don't even try to justify yourself. Oh, Jesus. You're getting there when you're prepared to listen to God and not to man, in spite of all the man's logic and reasoning and understanding. Peter could have done just that. Peter wasn't alone, you know. Jesus told Peter because he was captain of the boat. But there were other fishermen there. James and John were fishermen. They fished together. But I could have heard James saying, Peter, don't bother with here, you know. He know nothing about fishing. I could have heard John saying, oh, Jesus, we work whole night, and this man come in to tell us, go walk out in the deep again. Don't bother with that, huh? That them making any sense. And Peter could have listened to James and John and not to Jesus. And his net would have remained intact with no fish. As I said before, what Ben-Hadad demanded of Ahab was not an easy thing to let go of. All your gold, all your silver. Silver and gold here is the equivalent of all his financial possessions. All his financial possessions. And his wives, he might have wanted to let go of a few. Yeah, if you have several wives, all of them can be good. He might have wanted to give up one or two. And some of the children. Believe me, some of the children. He could have done it without some of them children. But you see, Ben-Hadad didn't want any old child. He said even the goodliest of them. That one was going to be hard, you know. That was no easy demand to meet. But recognizing the alternative consequence, what he would otherwise have lost, he said, my Lord, O King, according to thy saying, I am thine and all that I have. He surrendered it totally. Like Ben-Hadad, total surrender of our lives is what God requires of us. In order for him to do all that he wills in heaven to be done for us here upon earth. But all that I have said about total surrender, you know, that's easier said than done. I wouldn't lie to you. That's easier said than done. Because we still have this self-life. This self-life is powerful, you know. Oh, yes. It is fueled by an unfallen nature, a sinful nature. This thing called self. And it's fueled from external forces that we can't see. They can influence us to do things contrary to the will of God for our lives. So total surrender is not an easy thing. Self always wants to do what self wills to do, whether pleasing to God or not. Isn't that so? Yes. Yeah, whether it's pleasing to God or not, as long as self is pleased, self will do what self wants to do. Self seeks to please himself. This is why Jesus says the Father is always with me, because I do always those things that pleases him. This should be our focus in life, in everything we say, in everything we do, in all our relationships. Everything, our whole life should be lived to be pleasing to God. Totally surrendered. So it was no easy demand to meet. And this is why Jesus says in Luke 9:23, if any man will come after me, Let him deny self. You can't be totally surrendered. Could never be totally surrendered when self is on the throne. You've got to kick self off the throne and get Christ to reign in his life, in your life. It's not an easy thing to do, but as long as we are willing, I don't want to leave you to go out of this place feeling defeated. As long as we are willing, in spite of how hard it may be to totally surrender, God, by his indwelling Holy Spirit in us, and that's why it's important that you are born of the Spirit of God. You must have the Spirit of God, otherwise no go. God, by his indwelling Holy Spirit, is always there to help us. He has his methods, and he has his ways, and it is because of his methods and ways he has brought us to the place of partial surrender of our lives. And if he has brought us to the place of partial surrender, that area, those areas of our lives that we have surrendered, he can take it all the way. He can bring us to the place of total surrender. There is nothing impossible for the Spirit of God to do. We need only to ask and to yield ourselves as he makes his requirements known to us through his word, prophetically. However, we yield ourselves. It's not going to happen overnight. Salvation is a progressive thing. It is taking you out from the pits of hell and putting you on the road to heaven, but you got to walk upon that road. It's a progressive thing. You have a progressive sanctification. He doesn't take all away from you one time. Kill us. So, this morning we want to ask ourselves, if we can, we want to ask ourselves this morning. Let's stand. We want to ask ourselves, not the person next to you, not your husband, not your wife, nobody at all. Not. You want to ask yourself, am I totally surrendered to God? The worst thing you can do is to lie to yourself. You can't lie to the Holy Spirit. He knows all things. Am I totally surrendered? Totally surrendered to the Lord? You will know the answer within you, because if you are born of the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit will let you know whether you are totally surrendered or not. So then you can ask the follow-up question. What area of my life am I not surrendered to God? And he let you know by his Spirit what area of my life am I not surrendered to the Lord? And as he lets you know, the third question is, am I prepared to surrender those areas or that area, as the case may be? And if you are prepared, if you are prepared, the Holy Spirit will help you as you yield yourself. He helps you. He's not going to do it for you. He can't surrender you to himself. But he can help you surrender that area of your life to him, if you are willing. And your willingness, your true willingness, will be determined by whether you yield yourself. You give yourself to surrendering those areas of your life. Apart from all this, It means that you're not really ready to, you're not really ready to be totally surrendered to the Lord. So then what you're saying is you are prepared to stand the consequences, as Ahab would have stood the consequence of not surrendering. Ben-Hadad would have invaded Israel, and there would be a lot of loss and chaos in people's lives. All truth is parallel. And so, precious God and Father, I lift up myself before you. I lift up every member of this congregation and every other person that may be born of your Spirit. I know, Lord, that even while the message was being preached, that you were at work in people's hearts, showing them areas that they have not surrendered to you, whether it be in the area of gossip or things like that. A precious Lord, I pray this morning, as a congregation whom you have spoken to through your word and by your Spirit, that we, Lord, we, myself included, will understand that your heart's desire for us is to give us all that you have planned for us, as you said in Jeremiah 29:11. But for your plan to be executed here upon earth, two things must happen. We must be totally surrendered, and we must pray. I pray, Father, that none of us would leave here this morning having asked questions that you would answer within us, that we would leave here and not do something about those areas of our lives that are not surrendered to you, so that we can come to that place as Ahab and totally surrender to you as he did to Ben-Hadad. I give you praise and thanks for the message this morning in Jesus' wonderful name. Let's sing this chorus.
Lord, I surrender my life. give it all to you.
Life that we give to the Lord Jesus Christ. When we say, Lord, I give you my life, you must understand that it no longer belongs to you. It belongs to Him. It is for Him to do what He wills in the life that you have given to Him. Not for what you will to do if it's contrary to His will for your life. Let us begin to think of salvation as it should be thought of. A giving of our life in exchange for His life. The life that you live, according to Paul, in this body, it's His life. He said it this way, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. And the life that I now live, I live to the glory of the Son of God, who gave His life for me. I remember reading a book entitled My Body, His Life. A very powerful author. He's deceased now. I used to love that book. But the Lord has brought me beyond that book in understanding that it's not even my body. It's not even my body. It belongs to Him. And you will find it in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Your body is not even your own. So let us seriously think of this relationship we are supposed to have with God. As a people of God, let us begin to live the Christ life. Not live for ourselves. You're here this morning and you don't know this Jesus that we talk about, or you know the Jesus of the religion. You know the Jesus of Christmas. You know the Jesus of Easter and Good Friday and the Jesus that people talk about. The question is, do you know him? Do you know him? Did that exchange take place with your life for his life? If you are not born of his spirit, you're still separated from him. You are not his. He loves you. Believe me, he loves you. He says it in John 3:16. He so loved you, he gave his life for you. But he gave his life. The question is, did you receive it? And there is only one way to receive his life. That is to openly confess that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. Accepting him as your Savior and inviting him to come into your heart. Then you experience the miracle of the new birth, being born of his Spirit. Not just coming to church. It goes beyond that. It's a personal experience you have with the God of this universe. So if you're here this morning, you have never been born of the Spirit of God. This is an aspect, the first aspect of surrender that we talked about. Will you prepare to surrender your life to him this morning in exchange for his life? Would you prepare this morning to leave this place totally different as when you came in? Not perfect, but totally different. Came in a sinner, and you walk out of this church cleansed of all sin. It's up to you. He makes it available to you. He is God's gift of eternal life. Free gift, free gift. But he says, except you receive that gift, you can't be born of his Spirit. So if we just close our eyes in the presence of the Lord, and precious Lord, by your Spirit, move upon any heart here this morning. I know that the majority of this congregation is born of your Spirit, but in the event there might be one or two persons, even one, that are not yet born of your Spirit, tug at their hearts even now. Let them experience that drawing of your Spirit. And I pray, Father, that they would yield. They would yield to you. They would yield themselves to you. Knowing that they can receive your life into their life. And so I ask you this morning, if you are any such one here, at this moment in time when the Spirit of God is very present, if you would say, Jesus, I want you to be my personal Savior. I want you to come into my heart and be my Savior and be my Lord. Just raise your hand right where you are and we'll help you with it. Is there one? Is there one in the balcony? Yes, I see one person in the balcony. Okay, I see another here. Just wave your hand high so that I can see it. Even if I don't see your hand, God sees your heart. And that is what is important. Any other? Any other? But let's not take too much time. This is nothing to deliberate on. Heaven and hell, heaven or hell, is nothing to deliberate on. That's foolish. To choose to go to hell when a way have been made for you to go to heaven, it's foolish to deliberate on that. Okay? So we're not going to take any more time. If you have raised your hand as an indication, I want you to come down here and meet me. I'm going to help you with a prayer. You will experience your own personal miracle. And if you have not raised your hand, but you would want to join this lady or others, come. Come with them. Come. Someone in the balcony, we will wait on you. Come on down. think we are waiting on someone from the balcony. In the meantime, let me tell you that you have just made the best decision you will ever make in your life. Best decision. You've just made the best decision you will ever, ever make in your life. Okay, I just told these two young ladies they have just made the best decision they will ever make in their life. Now I want you to take it one step further and change it from a decision to a commitment. Okay, the difference is you can make a decision here and change it outside there. But if you make a commitment, and you know that commitment is to God who holds your very breath in his hand, you would want to keep that commitment. Okay? It's a word that I got saved with. Commit. Powerful. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to forget about me, forget about where you are, everyone. Just think about Jesus, who loves you, who gave his life for you, and wants to bring you into his kingdom. What you're going to be doing is you're going to be, he knows already, but you're going to be confessing that you're a sinner, because that's what his word says, if you confess your sin, okay? And then you're going to accept him as your savior and invite him to come into your heart. I'm going to help you with the words, but I want you to transform those words that I'm giving you into your prayer to him. And be as sincere as you possibly can. I want you to pray it out. Dear God in heaven, I come to you this morning, a sinner in need of a savior. I believe in all my heart that you, Jesus, left heaven's glory. You came to earth and you died for me. I believe with all my heart that you, Jesus, rose from the dead. And I now accept you, Jesus, as my Savior, as my Lord. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart, put your spirit in me, and teach me to live for you. By faith, I receive you into my heart, Lord Jesus, and I thank you for saving me. Amen. Do you know something? Before you finish the prayer, you were saved. He was just waiting. You see that when you breathe out, remember just now? The Spirit of God came into you. You're now born a child of God. You're now born a child of God. Your sins have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. You're a brand new person in Christ. There are some people standing behind you. They're going to make an appointment with you. Keep that appointment. It's very important. They're going to take you into the Bible and they're going to show you where you were, where you are now, what you received, and how to keep that which you receive. Okay? Come on, one more time. Let's welcome them to the kingdom of God. Thanks. Thank you. God bless you richly. You may be seated.